And the two things we're going to talk about before we get into the facade rule changes, and two things that are near and dear to my heart. So the first one is no report files. I know it says amnesty program on there, but we'll get to that in a second. So no report files is our big big population that we don't know a whole lot about, and that's concerning for us. If we get a safe, a swamp, or even an unsafe report, at least we know a professional has looked at the building, done an inspection, submitted a report, and we have information on that building. The no report files is a population that we know nothing about. And it's something that we are looking to get a better handle on here at the department. So in cycle six, we have 36 NRFs still, believe it or not. We have 245 NRFs from cycle seven and 1858 NRFs in cycle eight. So 1858, still a very large number of NRFs from cycle eight. So that leads us right into the amnesty program. The amnesty program is open for all owners that are NRF in any previous cycle, cycle eight, seven, six, whatever it might be. The facade unit is actively outreaching to owners with NRF in cycle six and seven, letting them know about the amnesty. What I would like from all of you, professionals, ownership groups, managing agents that are out there listening to this, please reach out to your groups and let them know about the amnesty program also. That being said, the amnesty program does have some rules associated with it, and one of them is to pay the civil penalties online before we accept the report. So please check with us on the amount of the civil penalty that is owed. Please reach out to the email address facades with an S at buildings.nyc.gov. That email address will be at the end of the presentation as well. They will let you know the civil penalties amount that are due. They are a little bit different due to the amnesty program. This facade customer service counter is closed due to COVID. So that's why I'm asking you to reach out via email. You can also call. The FIST amnesty reports will not be accepted unless civil penalties are paid in full. So please reach out to your ownership groups. Let's all work together and reduce the NRF numbers. That is much appreciated. So that is the first item that is near and dear to my heart. The second item is, oh my God, Jill just reminded me of something. And that's why the slide is on here also. This morning, as of this morning, a service notice was posted. I don't know how I forgot this. Thank you, Jill.
Seriously.
The amnesty program is being extended by 1 month till August 31st. So it is not ending on September 30th. We posted that service notice this morning. We also sent out a blast, an email blast to all 500 and change QEs that are out there. So let's work on getting the NRF numbers reduced. We have an extra month to do that, that our commissioner has authorized. So thank you very much. So please let's reduce those NRF numbers. Thanks, Jill. Incidents. So the second item that I like to talk a lot about, that'll be the last item, I promise, and then we'll get into the rule changes. So incidents. We've been working on this population of buildings since 1980. Obviously, the local law of 10 of 1980, right? So this population has been now 40 years of inspections, of reports, of back and forth between owners, professionals. The department is also involved in this, obviously. Yet we still have incident after incident. And something that has come to light recently, you've heard me talk about terracotta repairs and the failure of terracotta repairs extensively. So I'm not going to talk about that today. So you guys are all lucky. Glass on new buildings. You've heard us talk about that in the past extensively with the detailing and manufacturing issues. We are going to talk about cavity wall buildings, which we'll get to in a bit. But I'd like to start with EIFS. I know a lot of people call it EIFS. Either way, we've had a large amount of incidents with regards to this material. All the incidents that I'm talking about today, by the way, are very recent. So I'm talking here within the last month or so. This is not that we're going back into the archives here for the facades unit. The failure on this facade that we're looking at in this picture was very recent. It was during the tropical storm. And when we heard back from the owner or the professional, or maybe it was a managing agent in the very beginning, they said, you know, this was an extreme wind event. It was a tropical storm. And my response to them was very straightforward. You know, a tropical storm is not an extreme wind event. An extreme wind event is an event that is above and beyond the code level wind loads or 98 mile an hour sustained winds. I would consider that an extreme wind event. I've been practicing in New York City for a minute or so, and I have not had an extreme wind event in New York City. So let's be clear, things should not be flying off of buildings. Things should not be falling off of buildings in New York City. Okay, all owners must maintain their buildings safe, right? So to come back with a response that this was an extreme wind event is not going to fly. Okay, the elements on the facade ended up across the street. This is the same incident, by the way. Across the street, down the block, in the parking lot, adjacent to the building, these panels flew a considerable distance. You can see in the picture on the left that there are screws still sticking out of the metal studs that were anchoring the EIFS. So again, inadequate screws, inadequate number of screws, and the actual screws themselves were not the right type of screws to be used for this type of installation. Again, another EIFS incident that has occurred very, very recently. This one was not positively attached to the backup. It was just adhered to the backup with no positive connection. We did some research on this, spoke with ownership, found out that this was actually installed 9 months before it fell off the building. It actually survived through the tropical storm and then fell off the building about a week or two after that. But the fact that it was installed 9 months before raised a lot of red flags for us. Again, pieces were found in the neighbor's yard, in the rear yard, on the neighbor's roof. Nobody injured in either one of these incidents, thankfully. But again, this has brought to light a new material that, I'm sorry, an old material that is causing new problems for us in the facades unit. And I mentioned cavity walls. We've been talking about cavity walls since I've got here and with Tim Lynch before I got here in terms of the facades unit. Cavity walls, still having failures on a regular basis. The most recent failure is shown here. You can see that it's pretty high up on this building. It's a 19-story building. The failure occurred on the 12th floor. And of course, as luck would have it, they called this in on a Friday afternoon. So we had a busy weekend with this. And our inspectorial staff and our group of professionals that that helped with the response were amazing in dealing with this incident. So thank you very much to all of them. The problem again with cavity wall buildings, these are the larger size buildings, the taller buildings in our universe most of the time, and it's access. Getting to the point of where the failure occurred is very, very difficult. In this specific site, there were trees, there was some playground equipment, there was unlevel ground, fences that were in the way at the ground level and prevented us from getting a lift to this location. And then as you can see, getting a hanging scaffold down on this inside corner of the building was also something that we were not looking to do, given that the panel failed right at that inside corner. So again, a very difficult situation for us to deal with. We're still dealing with these incidents and the cleanup of them. And the last incident that, not specifically an incident, but the last topic that I want to talk about is concrete, and specifically concrete on balconies. I consider this to be a relatively pedestrian facade condition. I mean, whether it's steel supporting the concrete or the concrete is reinforced, I mean, we're talking about a relatively common issue when it comes to facade, which is the corrosion of steel that causes the deterioration of the concrete and pops the concrete off. You know, this is as straightforward as it gets. And like I said, since I started with the facade unit, we've been talking about this with individual QEs and registered design professionals. But we've had quite a few of these meetings and conversations over the last few months that I felt it necessary to present it and talk about it here. My concern is I don't understand why this is a constant issue. The repairs for this and the inspection for this is as straightforward as it gets. I understand that buildings have a lot of balconies. I understand that the repairs and access for this is always challenging, but that's the case for any of our FIST buildings. And the deficiencies that we're seeing in these pictures are just not going to be tolerated. Take a look at the concrete balconies, specifically the edges of the concrete balconies. Make sure that the concrete is sound. Make sure the concrete is in good condition. We need to stop situations like this from occurring. So we talked about incidents, and let's talk about what you need to do if you encounter an incident or an unsafe condition specifically. Obviously, the first thing is public protection. So the easiest thing to do is close off the sidewalk, close off the area where the unsafe condition is, put up a shed or something along the lines of public protection. That's a must, and that comes with contacting ownership. And then call it in. Call 311 or 911, 212 New York, if you're outside of the five boroughs with a cell phone. You file the unsafe notification on DOB Now Safety. And those are your immediate requirements. After you deal with the public safety and the immediate situation, you'll need to file that unsafe report and time extensions as necessary. And then obviously when the repairs are done, you file that amended report. Okay, so finally, we're getting to the rule changes. You guys all came here for the rule changes, so we're getting to that now. So apologies that took a little 20 minutes. I apologize. That was longer than I thought, but it was important. So I hope you all bared with me through that. The general facade rule, RCNY 10304 and code 28302, a lot of you are familiar with those two. Some of the changes that are associated with 10107. I want to highlight here as well, 10107, RCNY 10107 is approved agencies. And that section and the section of 10107 that talks about QE and specifically QE requirements. So you can see that here. One thing of note is for old QEs or QEs, I shouldn't say old QEs, QEs that were in our system before the rule change, you are grandfathered in. These requirements, specifically the 7 years of relevant experience, is for any new QEs, new prospective QEs. So just wanted to clear that up. And then below that, the bullet points that you see below there is all the information that we're going to want to see with you, from you. One thing to note, please check our facade webpage. We have an FAQ document on there. When we were going through all of the rule changes with the industry before the rules were promulgated, the rule change was promulgated, we got a bunch of questions from the industry. The ones that were most relevant and that came up most frequently, we put together an FAQ document based on that. So please review that. The grandfathering of the QEs is in that as well as detailed information, diagrams on drop locations, kind of tells you how many drops and what location we're looking at. But in general, check in on our webpage. We do have updates on there. So please look at that on occasion. So on to RCNY 10304. That's our main rule for facade compliance reports. To the left, you'll see the old format. And then we have our new format for the revised rules. One thing to note, the presentation is going to go in order of the FISP rule. And then we are going to put the rule section at the top of each slide, so you can reference that very easily. And everything in the rule is a minimum standard, right? So that's what we did when we revised the rule, when we changed the rule. We enhanced or we raised the bar with that minimum standard. But again, it's a minimum. It is a minimum requirement. There might be buildings out there, or you know what, I'll revise that statement. There are buildings out there that require more than the minimum. That is up to you, the QEs that are out there, the professionals that are out there, to determine what above and beyond the minimum you need to do for the specific buildings. Okay, responsibilities of a QE. So we talked about the requirements for a QE in RCNY 10107. In 10304, we have responsibilities of a QE. I just want to make it clear, in comparison to 10107, these responsibilities are for all QEs, grandfathered or not, or new QEs. These are for everybody. So maintain your records. That's very important for us. We will ask for your records if an incident occurs. We will ask for your records on occasion when we audit FIS reports, when we go back and look at them. So please make sure you have all of your records. And what do we mean by records? So it's going to be all of your field reports, all of your pictures, and not just the pictures that you are putting into the FIS reports. We're going to ask for all your pictures. We're going to ask for what research you did. Did you read all the old FIS reports? Do you have all the old FIS reports? Did you do any research on the building? Did you pull any old facade repair drawings? So again, after an incident, it's not the time for excuses about whether or not you kept your records or not. The expectation is you have those records and you can provide those in a very timely manner. And I have excellent news for all of you. This is my last slide, and Olga would have taken over. I hope she's feeling better today, but Jill is going to take over for her. Inspection programs. So obviously, I mentioned that there's only about 500 and change QEs, and we have in cycle 9 now about 16,000 buildings. So those of you who are used to me saying 14,500, that was the cycle 8 number. The cycle 9 number is about 16,000. So obviously the 500 QEs can inspect all 16,000 buildings. The new FISP rule has very specific requirements for who can do the inspections besides the QE. However, I will mention that the expectation is that the QE is the one who is ultimately responsible for a report. You folks are the ones that are signing and sealing the report. And you guys are the ones, guys or gals, are the ones that decide who can assist. And you must ensure that the people that are doing the inspections meet these qualifications. We went over these qualifications with the industry several times. We had a back and forth, and we revised these qualifications a few times, and we feel like they're fair. And we feel like these are the people that should be doing the inspections besides the QEs themselves. So we'll be check the qualifications of the people doing the inspection. And the answer is yes. After an incident, after an accident, again, if we audit the FIS reports, we will check, we will ask for the qualifications of the people, the education experience, et cetera. And that's, again, not the time that you wanna make sure that the people are qualified. Make sure the people are qualified before you have them go out on site and do the inspections for you. And with that, I'm going to have Jill take over the rest of the presentation. Then we will try and answer whatever questions you have. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. So yes, again, I'm sorry that you're stuck with me instead of Olga. I will try and cover this as expertly as she would. We're going to keep going over the rule changes. And as Yigal pointed out, at the top of each heading is the section of the rule. So if you're playing along at home, you can, you know, open up your rule, which I'm sure you've all read back and forth 10 times, and you know, maybe get some explanation as to why we did what we did. Probably the biggest change, I mean, there's a lot of big changes, but this is the hands-on investigation requirements. As Yigal mentioned, the requirements are in this rule and every other rule, they're minimum requirements. And previously, the minimum requirement was one drop on a street front. Obviously there's some very large buildings that cover a lot of street frontage. So we felt that we needed to raise that bar, as Yigal said. And so now we said we need a close-up inspection to be performed at intervals of not more than 60 feet fronting the public right of way. We provided a table in the rule that will give you an idea of the minimum number of drops. And we also, I know Yigal has mentioned the FAQ, we have the, or FAQ, everyone says it different, sort of like EFIS and EFS. I don't know who says EFS, but okay.
My wife.
Okay, apparently Yigal's wife, so sorry, Karen. So the FAQ, we put together, again, in response to a lot of questions we were getting based on the new rule. And in the FAQ, we actually have, I think, 3 representative sketches that will explain what needs to go into the 60 foot and how often you need to do drop, how many drops you need to do. And also we want to say on this topic that you know, any, well, we're kind of getting out of that timeframe now, but any inspections that were done prior to the effective date of the rule, which is February 20th, 2020, like if you did something in January and you're submitting your report and you only did one drop, that's fine. But once we get past that 1 year mark, I mean, as of now, if you're doing your drops, you know, you have to adhere to the rule. But if you did your drops in preparation of filing a 9A filing, that's still whatever rule was in effect at the time that you did your investigation. That's the standard. And then I know we got some questions as to drones. We get a lot of these questions and other forms of technology, high-res photos, non-destructive testing, and so on. The department's stance, as some of you may have heard us say 5,000 times, is that drones, high-resolution photographs, other forms of technology will not replace the hands-on inspection. We welcome this technology to help you be able to investigate your building, you know, more thoroughly, investigate it better, and, you know, in more detail. Certainly, we are not against any of this, any of these things. But as of now, nothing will eliminate the requirements for the close-up inspection. And also, regarding the drones, we've actually started. We have a kind of a task force in-house working on it, and how we're going to incorporate this technology both for ourselves and what you guys will use it as. And we are also a partner for a study with some of our sister agencies. So we are, you know, looking forward to using this stuff and seeing what we can do and, you know, hopefully making all of our lives better and safer. Yeah, I think that's all I need to address on this slide. Probes at the cavity walls. Oh, and by the way, I'm glad that Egal kind of pointed out that we were did this presentation in the order of how it appears in the rule, because as you know, there's reporting requirements, there's inspection requirements, then there's like penalties and so on and so forth. So as I was preparing, you know, in the couple hours I had to prepare for this, I was thinking like, wow, this presentation is really kind of disjointed, but it goes in the order. So you'll get some inspection requirements and then you get reporting requirements. So we'll touch base with cavity walls again. And other topics as they appear in the rule. So the probe at the cavity walls, as Yigal mentioned, and as he showed you some photos of, cavity walls are consistently problematic for us. We get incidents, unfortunately, on a pretty regular routine basis. It happens in the winter, it happens in the summer, it happens to buildings in Brooklyn, it happens to buildings in Manhattan. It happens, they're a problem for us. And so as such, you know, as Yigal said, we wanna raise the minimum standards. So we felt that it would be worthwhile to have a probe at a cavity wall at every odd cycle. So we're in cycle 9, that's an odd cycle. This is the first cycle for this. And as always, the QE determines the location of the probes. A minimum single probe per each required close-up inspection, however you wanna interpret that. You know, that's, we'll leave a certain amount of interpretation to the QEs. And basically the purpose of this probe, and I want to emphasize that the purpose, because then we do have alternatives, which is the last bullet point. The purpose is these things fail because typically they either have no ties or the ties have rusted away, because these buildings were built in the 1950s. That was to the 1938 code. Were cavity walls and wall ties mentioned in the 38 code? No. Then when it came on in the 68 code, they had certain requirements, but even if it was built in the 70s to those requirements, if there's a certain amount of, you know, moisture, even if the cavity wall was built as it was supposed to in, you know, per the 68 code, a lot of those ties may have rusted away by now. I mean, it's been a long time. And so what we want to know is where are the ties, what's their spacing, what's their condition, might we have a problem? So to that end, yes, we will accept alternates, non-destructive testing, borescopes. Is, you know, we've had some requests for that. And also with regards to if you just did a big repair campaign, you know, 5 years ago, and you have, you know, the special inspection reports or field reports showing, you know, what was installed, you know, showing that your cavity wall that you, you know, put in ties or what have you, we will accept that. And then if it's a new building and you did a cavity wall and you have the same thing, inspection reports, field reports, We'll take a look at that. But if in doubt, you know, give us a call, send us an email, and we'll take a look. And, you know, we definitely, I like to think that we have a reputation of working with you guys so that we can all get our buildings, be confident that our buildings are in a safe condition. One thing I want to bring up that we get a lot of questions is, do probes require a permit? Per RCNY 10114, most probes are considered minor work and don't require permits, and therefore would not trigger the need for a site safety plan or a site safety manager, coordinator, or anything like that. All right, selfies. Everybody loves selfies, right? This is a little bit of a misnomer. I just kind of like the photo because I thought it was kind of cool. But what we do want is detailed photo documentation of the QE or their inspectors. You all went over what are, you know, the people we accept as doing this work, doing the physical close-up inspection. A lot of people take a little bit of umbrage to this. Please don't. Unfortunately, you know, got to remember, we see everyone, we see everything, and we have had cases where there's been evidence of fraudulent inspections, fraudulent filings, and this is just the best thing we could think of to prevent that. So please do not be insulted. This is just gives us a level of confidence with all of our, you know, there's 16,000 buildings, which means we get about 25,000 filings. So we just want to be confident in what we're looking at. And, you know, you guys should hopefully want to help us in that confidence, I hope. Let's see, did I cover everything on here? I think I did. Oh yeah, the photo, and yeah, again, not necessarily selfie, can be get the rigger to take a picture of yourself in the window, like what have you. Just some kind of proof that a QE or someone was on the building at the time that, you know, if you want to be all dramatic and hold up a newspaper showing the date and the news of the day, you know, you can do that too. All right, mapping. So we added, this was funny, we added one word in this paragraph C3IIIG. There's 12 lines to this paragraph. We added this one word, mapping, in the first line. And it was funny, when we were presenting this to our staff, I actually totally glossed over it. And then I was like, oh wait, there's this. And this is pretty significant for all of us. So what do we mean by mapping? What are we looking for when we say mapping? It doesn't have to be as complex as this point cloud. But basically we want to know, when you find a condition that's unsafe for swarm, you know, where is it? How can we find it? When we send our inspectors out, or when we see repair drawings that were prepared by, let's say, a different professional than you, the QE, how can we find this, you know, this defect? So that's basically what it is. The fundamental of the whole, you know, facades unit, facades program, FISP, the rule, the law, is we want to know if your building is safe. How will we know? We want to know where these conditions are. I mean, a condition on a courtyard is slightly different than a condition on a street front versus a condition on a setback. We just want to know. All right. Okay, I have to, in advance, everyone, please bear with me. Although there are only 3 bullet points, there is a lot to this slide. Time frame for repairs of unsafe items. I was kind of debating on how to actually go about presenting this. My notes page is actually 2 pages long to this slide. So basically, as you know, for however long, I don't even know when it got introduced, but when you had an unsafe filing, you had to repair the condition. I think the code said, originally it was like 30 days, then we changed it to 90. And then, as you know, up until, I mean, still, actually, you know, the law says you have to repair your unsafe condition within 90 days. But, you know, with the recognition that not all, you know, some buildings are very large and complex, and not all repair campaigns can be completed within 90 days. So we introduced extensions, right? So you can request an extension through the FISP 1, the FISP 2 forms, you know, every 90 days, subject to review and you know, accept or reject by our plan examiners. But also, unfortunate consequence of that, of these extensions, is we were getting these unsafe conditions that were going on and on and on and on and on for years and years and years. And obviously, with an unsafe condition comes a sidewalk shed. Everybody hates sidewalk sheds for the most part. So we kind of discussed it in-house and kind of said, you know what, no repair campaign, no matter how big, complex, whatever your building is, should last longer than 5 years. So to that end, we now have, similar to a swarm date, we now have an unsafe repair date that your building needs to be repaired by that date. Timeframes of more than 5 years will not be accepted. And then hang on, I'm gonna check my notes here. So yeah, basically, this is our way of kind of making sure to fix the unsafe conditions, get the sidewalk sheds down, get your buildings in, and get the buildings of New York City into a good place. And another change that's actually not on the slide, but kind of applies as well, is swarm conditions. Obviously, you know, as we've had in previous cycles, if you have the same swarm conditions two cycles in a row, that's an unsafe. However, we also want to prevent against what we call the caulk repair, or the toothpaste repair. You know, you got the crack to throw some like Crest on it and it's fixed. We obviously don't love that. So basically, if the repair of a swarm condition fails within that cycle and is not properly corrected, you know, repair versus corrected, if it's not properly corrected, then it's unsafe. And I think that is all I need to say. Oh yeah, one more thing that's applicable to this slide, at least tangentially, is everyone's favorite topic of sidewalk sheds. When can you take a sidewalk shed down? I feel like we can never say this enough. If you're building a safer swarm, you don't need a shed. If it's unsafe, keep your sidewalk shed up until your amended report is accepted, okay? Because just because you file an amended report, we may not accept it. So if you file your amended report, take your shed down, and your report gets rejected, guess what? Your building is still in an unsafe status, and you can receive violations for not having a shed up. So wait until one of our plan examiners has reviewed your amended report, you know, change the status of the building to safer swarm, and then you take your shed down. Also, an alternative, just to show you that we're not all like mean guys and want to keep all these evil sheds up, you can do a partial shed removal request. If you have a building that, let's say, it fronts, I mean, the easiest example, okay, 280 Broadway, right? We face Chambers, Reed, and Broadway. We had a repair campaign done, as some of you who visit us often may have, I hope you've recognized that in the past couple of years. When they finished the Chambers Street side, they were still working on the Broadway and the Reed Street side. They put in a partial shed request and said like, oh, hey, can we take down the Chambers Street side? We send out one of our inspectors, you know, inspector will arrive in 2 minutes because they just have to walk outside. And then they look and said like, okay, all the repairs on this facade are done. We can take that shed down. So not only are we getting a shed down, that's less money, you know, the city's paying or the owner is paying for, you know, the shed, for rental of the shed or however it works. So it's an option that I want everybody to be aware of. And I think, you know, more people should use. Okay, whew, that was a lot. Photo requirements of the probe. See, this is what I mean when I say that it seems like the slides are a little bit out of order because now we're talking about cavity walls again, but this is this goes along with the photo requirements. Again, what we're looking for, we want to be confident in the construction of the cavity wall, the wall ties, the condition of the wall ties, the spacing, the installation, any other thing that may be indicative as to the soundness of the wall. And again, if you can, you know, if you have like a borescope and you can take screenshots or whatever, you know, that's fine too. Okay, what is subject to FISB? In my mind, this should be like the first slide, but you know, here we are on section 4 of subsection C. So, you know, it is what it is. All buildings over 6 stories, you know, that's been the rule for quite some time. Buildings with 6 stories and a basement, but not a cellar. A basement, obviously 50% is above grade, a cellar more than 50% is below grade. And also just want to point out, and you know, we've said this if you tuned in to Yigal's presentation this morning, there's this wonderful section of the admin code, the administrative code 28-301.1, and it's called owner's responsibilities. And basically it says that owners are required to maintain their buildings in a safe condition. So just because you're building 6 stories and you don't have to file a compliance report with us every 5 years, you still have to maintain your building safe. And if, you know, if you have a failing facade on a 5-story building, you know, you are subject to violations and whatnot, or we could, you know, make you put a sidewalk shed up if we deem it necessary. So, you know, just because your building's 5 stories or whatever, or the 5-story buildings in your portfolio, you're not like completely off the hook. Okay, I think that is Oh yeah, one thing also is that even if your building in the front is 6 stories, but let's say in the rear, it's 6 stories plus a basement, it is subject to FISP. So yeah, keep that in mind. I think I covered everything on this front. So yeah, penalties, everybody's favorite topic, just kidding. So yeah, we did revise the civil penalty schedule. Again, we looked at it and we hadn't really adjusted our penalties or our fees in, what was it, like 10 or 15 years or something like that. So totally out of sync with the costs of, you know, maintaining a building, totally out of sync with, you know, even just like inflation, you know, totally out of sync with modern times. So we quadrupled our civil penalty for failure to file. It used to be $250 a month, now it's $1,000 a month. Then we are collecting the late filing of $5,000 annually. We added also, again, in the push to try and get people to fix their buildings so that we can safely take down their sidewalk sheds, we have linked the failure to correct civil penalty to the length of shed. So for example, this year, if you have a shed up because you haven't corrected your unsafe condition, you are accruing $1,000 a month. But if you have, oh God, I just realized I'm setting myself to do math really quick. So hold on, bear with me. But let's say if you have a building that fronts, I'll make it easy on myself, that fronts 100 feet, right, of street frontage. And so you have 100 feet length of shed. That's $10 a foot. So that's now $2,000 a year. And the following year, it's going to be $20 a foot. So that's $3,000 a year. So I hope you see what we did there. We're trying to encourage you, quote unquote, to fix your building, get the shed down, safely get the shed down. Don't just take your shed down. You got to fix your building and, you know, let's correct these unsafe conditions. Finally, I know somebody very early on in the presentation asked me about a condition certificate. I told you it was coming. Here it is in our like third to last slide. Posting of condition certificate. This is available via DOB now. Even if your building has a, you know, accepted 8B or 8C filing, and so you're not actually going to file, you don't, you know, legally you're not going to file until 9B or 9C, you can still, this certificate via DOB now will print out whatever the latest condition is. So if you have an 8B filing that's safe or swarm, you still can print that out and you should post it. And not can print it, you should print it out. It's the law, actually. And so you should print out your certificate, post it in kind of a vestibule or a conspicuous place. And it will indicate the most recent condition of the exterior walls. So yeah, like I said, even if you're not filing for another 2 years, you know, you're expected to, you should print this and post. Now the question came up, okay, cycle 8 started in 2015. DOB now didn't start until September 2016. What if I filed before then? Good question. If so, you should contact the facades unit. I think I put our email address up there a couple times. We'll also have it at the end of the presentation. Just email us. We will get you your certificate that you can then print out. We'll email you the certificate that you can then print out and post. So definitely please email us. Subcycles, this is where we are right now, 2/21/2020. As Egal mentioned, and as I reminded him, that the amnesty program, we are in the amnesty program that has now been extended to October 31st. Happy Halloween, please take advantage. This is actually a really good opportunity to, you know, stop accruing civil penalties on a no report filed, on a failure to file. And not only that, it's always good for us to know what's in our population, to know, even if it's an unsafe, you know, it's better to have an unsafe than an NRF for all of us, because you won't be accruing any more penalties. We'll know where our unsafe buildings are. It's just kind of a win-win for everybody. So I really encourage you, you know, you, your clients, again, property management groups, what have you, please, please, please take advantage of the amnesty program. You have another, I think, 5 weeks. So it's definitely worth it. As promised, and this is almost the last slide, is actually a really fun one. This is the second to the last slide. This is contact information. If you have DOB now safety questions, we are good with facades. We are bad with IT, as our IT department can tell you. So if you have TOB now safety questions with the, you know, the technical aspect of DOB now, there is the address for that support. If you have facade questions, facade specific inquiries, please send it to facades@buildings.nyc.gov. I know I've put that address in the chat a couple of times. You can call in these COVID times, most of us working from home, it's probably better to email. We have several people monitoring that email address, whereas the phone number, we do collect voicemails and we do check them. It's just the email is checked a little more often. So that's probably the better way to contact us. And finally, again, fun photo. See, we're nice people. We mean well. Look at those smiling faces. This is pretty much the whole team. Our administrators, our inspectors, our tech staff, you know, you all and I are there. Let's see if you can pick us out. But yeah, we're just here because we all believe in the safety of New York, and we know you do too. You know, obviously you're attending the seminar, and I hope you got a lot out of it. I hope hopefully maybe enlighten some things. I will say, okay, it's 3:55, so I guess we have some time for some questions. Are there some questions we want to field? We just finished. Sorry, our coordinator came in. We're just I'm still on. So yeah, I'm gonna take some questions. Yeah, 10 minutes. I thought we had 5 minutes. We're going on 5 minutes. Just kidding.
There.
Oh yeah, why don't you bring that over there?
Hi, it's Gal again. We're getting a lot of questions related to when you can file in the amnesty period. Please take a look at the first service notice. I think we sent it in March regarding the amnesty. There are very specific rules with regards to the amnesty. One of the very first rules of the amnesty is that you must have an NRF in a previous cycle. So you can't just file early just because you want to. You can only file early if we don't have a report from you in a previous cycle. So I hope that's clear. So please, there are other rules to the amnesty. Please go through the requirements in that service notice. If you can't find the service notice, please email the facades unit. We can get that out to you. But again, the email blast this morning went out to all 500 and change QEs. There was a link on there to the previous service notice from the service notice from today, which has the rules to the service notice. What else are we getting a lot of questions about?
Sorry, I'm just scrolling through the chat.
Yeah.
Bear with us.
With regards to incidents, if you heard Dan's presentation at 1 o'clock, he went through a lot of the history with regards to incidents. If you weren't at that presentation, again, that presentation will be online. I did mention in the chat that the facades unit is looking to publish without naming names or addresses, but publish some of the more recurring incidents, just so the general population, the QEs, ownership groups that are out there do have a sense of the failures that we are seeing, so on and so forth. So again, that is a newsletter that we're trying to put together right now to let the industry know about the various incidents that occur. Which one, this one?
No, there's one about unsafe. Building is probably unsafe. by completion. Well, we still need to file timing section. So the question is, if a building is filed as unsafe and we close out the permit and receive a letter of completion, will we still need to file for time extension until the FISB report is accepted? I think once you file an amended, we turn them around pretty quickly.
So I think the question is getting to that you have yet to file the amended report. So you should have valid extensions until you file that amended report. Just because you close out the permit for the facade repair and sign off that job application, that has nothing to do with the facade compliance reports. The facade compliance reports deal with the status of the building. The permit and the application for the facade repairs deal with the repairs. So please understand that just because you signed off the job application or the job permit, that you still have an unsafe status on that building until we accept the amended report. And I'll take that a step further. You should have all public protection installed until the amended report is accepted as well. We do 100% inspections on amended reports, and unless the unsafe report indicated that no public protection was required or there was a partial shed removal request that was approved previously, the inspector will be looking for public protection as part of that inspection. So if you don't have that, they will issue a violation. So that is very important for us that you maintain the public protection until that unsafe status has been changed to safe or swamp.
Laura had a question. By the way, Laura is an ex-colleague of ours. So hi, Laura. Are there penalties for not posting the condition certificate? Yes, there will be penalties. It will be an ECB violation, and our inspectors have been instructed to write it. So yeah, definitely get to printing out your certificates, get them posted. Again, similar to like the elevators, you know, they have their postings in the elevator. Just get your, even if it's NRF, you know, even if it's no report filed, even if it's unsafe, whatever it is, get that posting up because that's part of the law now.
And just to reiterate what Jill said in the presentation, in case you missed it, and in case you missed our most recent email blast with regards to the condition certificate, all buildings at this point, whether or not you filed the Cycle 9 reports, all buildings should have a condition certificate up at this point. We are more than 30 days past the promulgation of the rule. So therefore, you need a condition certificate, even though you have not filed your Cycle 9 report. The condition certificate will have the status of the latest filed report. And one thing also I want to reiterate that Jill said in that short slide that she talked a lot about, repairs. The repairs for swamp conditions, and honestly, the repairs for the unsafe conditions. The expectation is that you don't just do a repair that will get you through till the next cycle. As Jill said, I thought that was pretty good. Crest repair, right? So the
not sponsored by.
Not sponsored by. So apologies. It is very important that you repair the condition that is causing the deficiency of the facade. As Dan has mentioned numerous times, and Tim as well, the majority of these issues, and you saw it in the picture with regards to the balcony, is steel and the corrosion of steel behind the various elements. So if you don't take care of the root cause that is causing the deficiency on the facade, that condition is just going to happen over and over and over again. And it's not going to be tolerated anymore at this point. As I said, we've been going through this for 40 years now, since 1980. And at this point, these types of repairs are just not going to be tolerated anymore. Anything else, or we will close out? The chat, we're going to get a copy of the chat. If there's any questions that we missed, we can post it as part of the presentation, and we can answer questions as part of a FAQ document, or if we feel that it's if it raises to the level of a question that's been asked numerous times, we'll post it to the FAQ document on the facades webpage. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
We appreciate all your time, and we appreciate all of you listening in. And as Jill mentioned, please take advantage of the amnesty, and let's reduce those NRF numbers, please. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.